As many of you know, this event is put on by the Department of Conservation and Recreation, the Friends of the Hull Public Library, the Hull Lifesaving Museum. We have Buttonwoods Books here tonight selling books this evening, which is great. And we also have Hull Cable Access Television filming this lecture series. Without any further ado, I would like to introduce tonight's speaker. Tonight we are honored to welcome Dr. Sam Forman. Dr. Forman is a historian, Harvard University faculty member, and businessman. He is educated in the history of the American Revolution and the history of science, as well as the practice of clinical and preventative medicine. Throughout his successful career as a physician, military officer, and businessman, he has published and lectured on historical topics that inform current issues. His most recent novel, which is in the back of the room, Dr. Joseph Warren, The Boston Tea Party, Bunker Hill, and the Birth of American Liberty, is described as being a biography that is engaging and astoundingly well-researched. Finally, a definitive biography of the most important yet sadly forgotten revolutionary. In his book, Dr. Forman tackles a project that modern historians have shied away from. His biography of Warren is an ambitious debut and a volume sure to become the definitive story of a worthy national figure. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Samuel Forman.
Thank you. It's great to be here. I'm really pleased to see such a wonderful showing on a weekday evening. Now, I live in Brookline, and I'm a Massachusetts transplant for, I guess, about 18 years now, and I'll be here for the long term. But as I understand it, you have to count your lineage in generations to be a local. So I will make horrible mistakes at various times. I will mispronounce Worcester as Worcester. I might pronounce Scully as Scully, and horrible things, but please excuse me. I first encountered Joseph Warren as a student of history and the history of science in college way too many years ago than I would want to admit, and I was fascinated by him at that time. Now, I didn't go into history full time, but rather went off into medicine and business before I returned to this several years ago. And I actually had the advice of my father, who was a crusty former Coast Guard enlisted man. And I told him, Dad, you know, you've helped me go through college, and I'm very beholden to you for that and appreciative, but I'm thinking of doing two things. One is to be an historian, and the other one is to be a doctor. So he feigned deliberation. I think he knew the answer pretty quickly as to which way I should go, but he wanted to make sure that I thought that he was thinking about it. And he came with this cryptic piece of advice. He said, Sam, even Jesus had a day job. What intrigued me about Joseph Warren initially was a picture. This picture is an icon of American history. It shows up in all the history books that touch on Boston during the American Revolution, the Battle of Bunker Hill, anything that has to do with this time period of the early conflict between what was to become the United States and Great Britain. This picture shows up in variations. This is actually a colored woodcut from the 1790s. The original is down in New Haven in Connecticut. There is a artist-authorized copy painted by John Trumbull himself at the Boston Museum of Fine Arts. This painting might have even been more recognizable than it is today. John Trumbull in 1820 had the opportunity of putting forth seven pictures to be painted by him in gigantic reproductions of paintings that he had already produced, American historical paintings, for the U.S. Capitol Rotunda. This was one of the seven. Now, budgets were tight then, and they cut from seven to four. This was cut. So to the extent that we see this picture now, it often is just called the Battle of Bunker Hill. Sometimes you'll see pieces of it on the covers of other books. But it almost never goes by its original title, The Death of Major General Joseph Warren at the Battle of Bunker's Hill, June 17, 1775. Now granted, I guess we like shorter titles for things than they did in 1785, but I think it also shifts in emphasis from a time period where Joseph Warren was a household name, nationally famous for at least two generations in the Confederation and the early Republic, to a time period now where he's virtually unknown even in the neighborhood that contains Bunker Hill in Boston. Let me give you an example of the extremes. And I know this sounds like a setup of a joke. It's not. How famous was he? Well, this good Boston boy, who never ventured more than 75 miles outside of town, has counties named for him and cities in Michigan, Pennsylvania, New York, Connecticut, but also below the Mason-Dixon line, North Carolina, Virginia, Mississippi, Kentucky, Missouri, all named prior to the Civil War. Not bad for a good little Boston boy. Not only does he show up in place names and pictures that were widely reproduced in that time frame, but some of the first American plays had Joseph Warren and the heroics at Bunker Hill as their subject matter. The first commercial play performed in Boston in 1797 was about the death of General Warren at Bunker Hill. Was also performed in New York City. Now, one of the things that attracted my attention, just beyond this specifics of his former fame, was how obscure he has become. I visited the Boston Museum of Fine Arts recently. I don't know if you've had. I highly recommend it. They have a new American wing. It's been there for a year or two. And you walk into the first floor, and right there, right in front of you, is a picture of Paul Revere. Wonderful picture of Paul Revere. And you go off to the left, and you'll see a line of these prominent Boston activists, sons of liberty from the Revolutionary period, men and women, many of them painted by John Singleton Copley, so they're compelling both as pieces of art and pieces of our collective American history. And there they are in a line, John Hancock, Samuel Adams, Joseph Warren, Mary Otis Warren, Mercy Otis Warren. So I was hanging around there as the biographer before the book was published. And there are many visitors, of course, to the museum from this area, but from afar. And the crosstalk was, who's this guy? Who's Joseph Warren? The implications are he doesn't belong there. If you walk around the corner, you'll see Trumbull's copy of the Battle of Bunker Hill as well. Well, this guy's resume included, by the time he was 34 years old, leading physician in Boston, president pro tem of the Massachusetts Provincial Congress, effectively the governor of Massachusetts, the head of its secretive Committee of Safety, the head of the Massachusetts Militia and Minutemen, chief mason for all of North America, for the Scottish Rite Masons. And by the way, contemporaries noted that the ladies judged him handsome. So, as a young college student, I was just fascinated by that. I mean, how can that be? What about that is not true? What did the guy really do? What was he really like? He was famous for these battlefield heroics, but he was only a major general for about 3 or 4 days, depending on how you count them. And his commission was never confirmed, so he never really was a major general. His entire life was spent in these other pursuits. So there was just a lot of reasons that compelled me to look further at this fellow. About 6 years ago, I was successful enough in business to return to this interest, and the most voluminous surviving documents about Joseph Warren, by Joseph Warren, about him, are right here in the Boston area. So I rapidly found out why he was not the subject of recent biographers. The most voluminous surviving documents of Joseph Warren are the records of his medical practice. Even then, they're not complete. They're at the Mass Medical Historical Society. And they're basically financial documents that coincidentally have some medical content and other content in there. But they're about a kind of medical practice that's so arcane that previous historians couldn't make heads or tails out of it. And that's the most voluminous thing. Then on the political side, there are documents, speeches he wrote, and that sort of thing. But the personal side of it and what he was doing for years before, cryptic, incomplete. I mean, if I were an historian who was a full-time academic, I wouldn't get into this. You would have no guarantee of success, of being able to really get at who this person was and what his contributions were. I found that there were only 2 other scholarly-based biographies ever written about Joseph Warren. One of them in 1865, and the most recent one 50 years ago. Neither of them dealt much in Warren's personal life for the lack of source material, or even if there were source material, reluctance in speculating around the missing parts. So I thought that I maybe had the background to do this, because the odds and ends in my background of being a physician, being knowledgeable about the history of science and medicine, enabled me to look at these account books as a keyhole into the life of Joseph Warren, and then to look laterally into the existing documentation of his associates, of his patients, much more deeply than anybody had ever done before, and to back into his life. If we have time, I'll give you an example of how I did that. But in this talk, I was going to do 2 things. One is just say more about Joseph Warren. Even those people who are confident that they know who he was and what he did often don't have a view of the totality of what he did. If for no other reason, no one has ever really described it. So they may know him as the fighting general, the hero of Bunker Hill. Or at the Medical Society, they may know him as a leading physician of Boston. And as a Mason, they're tremendously proud of him, justifiably so, and have awards named after him. But they have their own legends about the life of Joseph Warren that don't turn out not always to be based on what he was really like. So I will cover some about the basics of Joseph Warren, who he was, and I have been sharing with you some of the historiographic challenges, and I'll do a couple of short readings, and you could judge how successful or unsuccessful I was with resurrecting the life of a worthy American founder. He was born in 1741, Roxbury, when it was an independent town and now it's part of Boston, on a farm that had been farmed by Warrens for a couple of generations. They have been credited with one of the first apples in America, which is most frequently misnamed as the Roxbury russet or the Boston russet. Of course, its real name is the Warren russet, and it was domesticated to American climate from English imports, possibly as early as the late 17th century, but certainly involved Joseph Warren's father and probably his grandfather in refining it. If you look around in farmers markets in the fall, you can still find them. They're very distinctive apples, and I won't go off on that tangent unless there's some horticulturalists who could come afterwards, and I'll tell you about them. Joseph Warren went to Harvard, class of 1759, was very interested in becoming a doctor, and he apprenticed to a Dr. Lloyd, who was the leading physician in Boston at the time. And at that time, if you wanted to go into medicine, there weren't so many choices. If mommy and daddy were very well off, you could convince them to send you to European medical colleges in London, in Scotland, or the continent for your education. And that was certainly the most prestigious way into medicine. Short of that, which most people couldn't afford, was to apprentice yourself to a very well thought of physician who did have that kind of training, Dr. Lloyd. There was a third route, and that is just to put out a shingle and say, I'm a doctor. Yeah. And if people came to you, that was the proof of it, there was no licensing. So things we take for granted for like government board of consumer protection for licensing doctors and nurses, I mean, no, nothing like that. The doctors themselves were very concerned with quackery and people coming into medicine through that route, and there were a general shortage of doctors. So there were concerns around that area. Joseph Warren joined the Masons in 1761. He met some interesting people when he was there, like John Hancock and Paul Revere. He didn't really become active in Masonry until about 1765 because he was very busy with his apprenticeship, which he finished in 1763, began his practice in Boston. Now, this outline that I have on this slide was pretty much the extent of knowledge about Joseph Warren in these time frames, especially these early formative time frames. There are very, very few bona fide anecdotes from this time. I talk about one of them extensively at Harvard, which sounds like a legend, like Washington chopped down the cherry tree sort of thing. You wonder if it's true. And I talk about that in the book. But I think that's in part symptomatic of just the lack of primary data from this time frame that people had written down. Now, we do know that he volunteered for a very gutsy thing as a doctor in 1764 during a big outbreak of smallpox in Boston. The preferred treatment in that time frame was to inoculate yourself against catching smallpox in the wild by being deliberately inoculated with live smallpox under controlled conditions. It's called inoculation. Not to be confused with cowpox and Jenner and smallpox immunization. That dates from way after Joseph Warren was dead. Now, this is inoculated with live smallpox under the care of doctors and nurses, with the notion that intensive nursing care and medical care would be far less mortal than catching smallpox in the natural way. And indeed, they kept statistics, and it certainly was. You were 10 times less likely to to die from wild caught smallpox if you were inoculated in this manner. But even so, 1 in 100 people who were inoculated died just through the treatment. Joseph Warren volunteered to be the house physician for a smallpox hospital doing these inoculations. It was an isolation hospital to keep people isolated during the time that they had this actively induced smallpox. It's very unclear whether he himself had ever had smallpox, and he may not have been immune, making this a very medically nervy thing to do. It also involved a lot of recognition from the town, both for himself and his colleagues, because they successfully inoculated the majority of the inhabitants of the town of Boston in cooperation with the town of Boston to enforce epidemic control type measures and isolation of the smallpox hospital, and the physicians banded together to do these treatments under private practice situations. Really quite impressive. That really put Joseph Warren on the map as a physician to be respected, even though quite young. So when he encountered what he believed was a malpractice situation involving another physician in the community, Dr. Young, Joseph Warren sort of appointed himself in the newspapers under the pseudonym Philo Physic as the lover of medicine. This notion of Joseph Warren writing under pseudonyms was actually another avenue to get at what he was like as a person. Because under these pseudonyms, and the newspapers encouraged this at the time, people would just let op-ed pieces rip with sarcasm and jokes and all kinds of asides, sort of like a worldwide wrestling foundation thing in the newspapers. Because there wasn't any lawsuits for malpractice, so this is how it was being fought out. The idea of writing under pseudonyms was something actually adapted from London papers and European papers. It was quite common at the time, and Joseph Warren just loved it. And the pseudonyms themselves allowed people to write very confidentially, but also had another level of evil fun to it that I think the editors encouraged, that you never really know who these people were writing under the pseudonyms. They could have been your neighbors. Now, ostensibly, the reason to have the pseudonyms was to concentrate in on the content of what was being talked about rather than was this your neighbor in Boston or in an outlying town. But really, it also encouraged second guessing, you know, who these people were and that sort of thing. I was able to unmask one of the pseudonyms by finding the original document and hiring a forensic handwriting analysis of the kind that go into court to match the handwriting to a 23-page speech written out by Joseph Warren as the gold standard and unmasked one of his pseudonyms. So you did have to get creative to get at some of the source material because it wasn't exactly waiting for you in the archives. So let's go back to these account books. There's a couple of them left, and here's what they look like. And you'll see dimly the signature of Joseph Warren. Now, these books would sit in the active medical office of Joseph Warren. It sat on Hanover Street, at least from about 1770 to 1775, approximately under where City Hall is now. So there's nothing really left to see there except a rather ugly stone building. It doesn't have anything to do with the 18th century. But these books were present in the room while these treatments were going on. They're very frail. There are rules in the archives of how you handle these things. But I have to tell you, and I'll bring your attention to that spot in the upper right-hand corner, that although the rules of the archives are to wear gloves for the integrity of the priceless document, As a physician, I would find myself washing my hands a couple of times every time following using these things, because I would have a mental notion of what went on in the pre-antibiotic era in a doctor's office without anesthesia or much of anything else that we would be familiar with, and was right there with these account books. I don't know what that splash is, and I didn't want to find out. The account books, and there's a picture in the upper right. That's one of the pictures in the Museum of Fine Arts. That is Joseph Warren's friend from the Masons, John Hancock, the richest person in Massachusetts and a leading Whig from about 1765 on, the Whig being synonymous with patriot. John there has the account book, which is the sign of someone involved in international trade and ledgers and banking. But in fact, virtually all tradesmen kept account books because there was a shortage of cash in Massachusetts at the time. So everybody, it was a barter economy basically, and everybody owed somebody else for services and would be noted in account books. So I transcribed the account books into an electronic database, and were able to manipulate them in ways that had never been suspected of the order in which patients were seen, amounts, stuff like that, rather prosaic stuff. But I'll give you an example of some of the conclusions that one could get from that that you were previously unsuspecting. Here's a typical page, page 3 of the account book, Mr. John Wheatley, tailor. And these things are laid out not too differently from your checkbook ledger. There's charges on the left and payments on the right, debits and credits. In there are dates of service, amounts charged. There are side notations on prescriptions, sometimes diagnoses, the names of the people being treated at times, and the account holder, Mr. Wheatley, would be the equivalent of the subscriber to Blue Cross Blue Shield, right? And you have people in your household. Now, there are no insurance companies, so the person who has to keep track of these billings and collect on them are the physicians themselves. Okay. Mr. Wheatley had some very interesting people in his household. Phyllis Wheatley, and this is around the beginning of Joseph Warren's practice, which was 1763, and he's in practice continuously up to the outbreak of the American Revolution in April 19, 1775. So this is 1763-64. Joseph Warren just opened his practice. In the Wheatley family, although it probably didn't take too much notice at the time, had bought a domestic slave off the docks around 1761, a sickly little girl about 7 years old, whom they named Phyllis after the slave ship that brought her. So let me read you a little bit about what I was able to infer and speculate on based on this and other material, spotty at best, known from this time period. Mr. Wheatley found it convenient to obtain medical care for himself and his household from the young physician. His daughter, Mary Wheatley, took ill early in February 1764, possibly from a complication of her smallpox inoculation. Joseph closely and frequently attended to her, whom he familiarly identified as Miss Polly in his accounts. Perhaps Mary Wheatley, then a year or so Joseph's junior, encouraged such close attendance. She may have shared the opinion concerning the young physician that the ladies judged him handsome. Father Wheatley may have grown concerned that the ambitious bachelor was paying too much attention to his nubile daughter. observing this drama and perhaps conscripted as a sounding board to Miss Mary Wheatley was the preternaturally talented enslaved servant Phyllis. Just a few years from being purchased off the Boston docks from the ship captain who had transported her from Africa, the preteen domestic already exhibited an uncanny aptitude and facility for the English language and its literature. Goings on in the Wheatley household would have been an introduction for Phyllis to the mating rituals of the white colonial middle class. I wonder if Phyllis Wheatley, in turn, made an impression on Joseph Warren. She may have been under his direct care at one point. She would have been in close proximity to her ill mistress in the Wheatley household as Joseph Warren was in attendance. One can conjure a scenario where Phyllis, the Wheatley daughters, and Joseph engaged in an impromptu interchange, quoting Pope, Addison's Cato, and Roman classical poets, much as Joseph enjoyed bantering with his fellow Harvard alumni. Such interactions are purely speculative, yet I find it hard not to believe that Joseph Warren would be impressed by the possibilities of human nature unbound by racial stereotypes if he spoke and interacted with Phyllis Wheatley. Surviving documentation does not reveal Warren's opinions on chattel slavery of Africans. He never took a public stance on the issue. Private and professional actions hint at a complex formulation. Some patriots, like his associate John Hancock, decried unrepresentative taxation as slavery while they owned black slaves prior to the Revolutionary War. Others, like James Otis, publicly and consistently decried enslavement of every kind. In 1770, Joseph Warren bought an African domestic slave boy, though no other details of that episode survive. Warren's medical practice was notably blind to race. There were no Jim Crow or back of the bus in Joseph Warren's clinical practice. Whether one was John Hancock or Data Boses, an otherwise unknown slave, Joseph Warren attended them in the order of their appearance with an intensity dictated by clinical need and with the same treatments for all. The philosophy behind such an approach was summed up by one of the dynasty of Warren physicians who emulated Joseph's example. Quote, "When in distress, every man becomes our neighbor." This simple humanitarian practice style, evident in Joseph Warren's actions, if not his words, and unrecorded by contemporaries, may have impressed the young Phyllis. With respect to Dr. Warren's ministrations to Mary Wheatley, outlasting the clinical need, Mr. John Wheatley may have wanted better for his daughter than for her to marry a Roxbury farmer's orphan. Better to terminate the arrangement before anything serious might happen. John Wheatley paid off his debt in full to the young doctor and terminated all further services to the family on July 14, 1764. By then, Joseph Warren was courting another merchant's daughter, Elizabeth Hooton, whom he married 7 weeks later. So in that example, I exhibit some of my methods, both good and bad. One is to try to reflect on some aspect of the beginning of Warren's practice, which has otherwise been a big hole to previous biographers. I have no idea what happened to him. Now, I do make a wild assertion there, that Joseph Warren may have been flirting with one of the Wheatley daughters. And I didn't take that lightly. I tracked down Professor Vincent Coretta, whose new biography of Phyllis Wheatley has just come out. He was writing Phyllis's biography at the same time I was writing. He works down at the University of Maryland. And I contacted him to see if he knew something about Mary Wheatley and people who were whose names were showing up in the account books that I didn't have much context for. So he was able to tell me the demographics of Mary Wheatley and whom she eventually married and that sort of thing, but it was rather sketchy. He was very struck by the fact that Joseph Warren was calling her Polly, which is a very familiar name, and there was no other Mary in that household. So he was struck by that. And then the timing of Joseph Warren's marriage, circumstantial things. But it turned out that it was such a hole in Phyllis Wheatley's experience that Vince Coretta ends up footnoting my biography in Phyllis Wheatley's biography. This is a hole in Phyllis Wheatley's history as well. Now, there's a couple of several things I've done in the book which will please some and probably irritate others, so I'll be very upfront about it. This is a biography where there are gaps in the original documentation, big enough gaps to scare away biographers and academicians by the generation, right? So what I do is several things. When there is original documentation, and some of the political letters and op-ed pieces and stuff are there, quite complete, I will offer them up in great detail. So rather than snipping little quotes, you'll see extended, original, often full quotes of these documents. So if you think you have a different interpretation of them than I would, you've got the data there. And indeed, when you make these conclusions off of just one document or two, it's a pretty shaky thing to do historiographically. So I will put my views of how I put it together, but there'll be enough of the original documentation, if it's there, that you can make up your own mind. I mean, right down to the original capitalization, spelling, and punctuation, if I was doing the transcription myself or could otherwise get to it. Other things I do is when I speculate, I clearly say that that's what I'm doing. I noticed that some biographies nowadays seem to blur that. There are some excellent histories of folks who perhaps weren't as well described in the past as the Thomas Jeffersons and the George Washingtons. And it seems the standard of some historians not to say where they're speculating and reconstructing dialogue and where they aren't. Well, when I was trained in history a few decades ago, nada, never. So when I speculate, I label it as such. It may actually irritate people sometimes because you would like to tell a continuous, smooth narrative. But in fact, I don't think the source material allows you to do that honestly. At one point, there's a fictional bridge that I just felt that I had to put in, and it's clearly labeled as such. So like it or hate it, that's the way it is. Oh, here's one I didn't expect. Thomas Hutchinson, Tory Lieutenant Governor of Massachusetts, later the Governor of Massachusetts, on the wrong side of the Boston Massacre and the Boston Tea Party, was Warren's patient. That's interesting. So were a number of other leading Tories. Now, this is in the 1760s, so there wasn't as sharp differentiation as later occurred by the time of the Revolution. But I was struck by this. And I was also struck by the timing. And what I found out, and again, this is this idea of looking at the account books and then looking laterally through the keyhole, that this timing of May 1767 was no random timing. There was a convening of the Massachusetts General Court by then-hated Governor Francis Bernard, and Thomas Hutchinson was expected to be by his side. And the Whigs were going to excoriate the governor for allegedly sending letters critical of Massachusetts patriots and lawlessness to the ministry. Thomas Hutchinson called in sick. He wasn't there. He said he had a stroke. He was cared for by Joseph Warren for 12 consecutive days in early May of 1767, possibly in Milton at the seat of the governor, Thomas Hutchinson, lieutenant governor at the time. And also, during this time frame, there was these op-ed pieces going on. Before this time frame, Joseph Warren wrote newspaper articles as Pascalos, an apparently non-aligned, that is non-aligned with the Patriot Party, such as it was, Sons of Liberty, but leaning in that direction. One of the differences of Pascalos, who was actually Warren under a pseudonym, was that he actually advocated that the Massachusetts House of Representatives authorize a spending bill to reimburse Hutchinson for the destruction of his mansion in North Boston during the Stamp Act riots. This is not a popular thing for Whigs or Patriots to advocate, but Joseph Warren, as Pascalos, did. During the time frame that Joseph Warren was treating Hutchinson, he stepped back from politics. And at the time of the last treatment of Hutchinson by Warren, Warren starts his op-ed pieces again as a true patriot, which was as outspoken and as vociferously anti-Tory and loyalist as you can get. In fact, in what I think his second letter as a true patriot, Governor Bernard threatened to bring a lawsuit for defamation of character against the publisher. So, the implication is Joseph Warren was flirting with Toryism during this time frame. Maybe, maybe not. But it's circumstantially very interesting. He certainly stepped back from patriot politics during the months that he was treating Thomas Hutchinson. Now, I speculate as to why that should be. There was a bill that Warren and his medical friends were hoping to get through the legislature to license physicians. And perhaps he was looking to Hutchinson for support of that bill, or at least just to learn how the political landscape worked. Well, the bill didn't get anywhere because there were obstructionist politics between the Whigs and the Loyalists at that time, so the bill died. But this is the time that the physicians went forth with a bill to license physicians in Massachusetts, and it failed. By 1768, Joseph Warren had met up with Samuel Adams, who's said to be a recruiter for young Whig talent. These were like a younger generation of activists whose names, well, an audience like this would be familiar to many of you. Josiah Quincy Jr., John Adams, Thomas Young, Benjamin Church. These people were said to have been recruited by Samuel Adams, who was sort of like the elder political mentor of these people. I map out Joseph Warren's development as a patriot, which I don't think has ever been done. Some of it's speculative, and it's far more nuanced than simply being recruited by Samuel Adams. However, by the late 1760s, Samuel Adams was Joseph Warren's mentor in political matters, and they were closely aligned by then, both politically and as friends. A few years later, Samuel Adams' only surviving son became Joseph Warren's medical apprentice, as Joseph Warren himself, being more respected as a leading physician of Boston over the years, took on apprentices himself. Samuel Adams Jr. was one of them. Paul Revere, fellow Mason, son of Liberty, personal friend, different social classes. Paul Revere of the artisan class, although very highly rated for his being a jack of all trades and successful at many of them. The main one he's known for is a silversmith. But an iconic episode of this period is the eve of the Revolutionary War, when Paul Revere goes on that iconic ride. And Paul Revere actually recalled that three different times in letters and affidavits, one of them just a few days after the event happened, the other one that's most widely quoted to the Mass Historical Society in 1798. All those accounts will differ very slightly, very much part of the legendary origins of the United States, but all of them have one aspect in common. Paul Revere was called urgently to Joseph Warren's medical office in his house on Hanover Street on the evening of April 18th, 1775, and told exactly where to go, what the British plans were, and exactly what to do. It is a, I would say, continuing mystery of history as to how Joseph Warren knew intelligence so accurate. He also sent Dawes on the ride. He may have been more responsible for those lanterns being set than Paul Revere is given credit for. But at any rate, Warren is the proximate person who pulled the trigger on the Revolutionary War, which is the Lexington Alarm. Paul Revere's legend overcame Joseph's legend in the 19th century. That's a whole story in itself, but they were certainly friends at the time, one the subordinate of the other. Talk about absence of primary documents. This one was frustrating. By 1773, by December 1773, and the tea crisis, Joseph Warren was already acknowledged to be in the inner circle of leading patriots for strategizing, for delivering political speeches, for doing all sorts of stuff. And immediately after, he certainly was in that role. But in the Tea Party itself, there's nothing that has his fingerprints on it. Now, it's known that he was there on the podium in the iconic meetings at Old South Meeting House, as Samuel Adams was chairing some of those meetings. Publicly determining before Boston and people from surrounding towns as to what to do with this tea that had landed and the hated tax that they didn't want to pay, and then Governor Hutchinson refusing to send it back. There's just one little ditty that survives from a broadside that was published by Eads and Gill, I think, and posted in the days after the what we call the Tea Party, or they called the destruction of the tea at the time. And that is, it refers to Paul Revere and Joseph Warren. Words to cheer, hands to do, for liberties and law. And that's it. It's pretty indirect. I think that Joseph Warren had a whole lot to do with the destruction of tea, and this was one of the tough things to do. So I speculate on what his role was. It is just that, speculative. But I don't think he was passive. So what history has done, though, is in the absence of any surviving documentation, just gloss over it. He didn't do anything. In fact, there are books. There's a wonderful one just out not too long ago by Professor Karp from Tufts University about the destruction of the tea, called The Rage of the Patriots. And Karp has lists, as best could be pieced together, of participants in the Tea Party. Of course, families have been very proud of this if they have relatives that can date back to Tea Party participants. Those books have been appearing since the 1830s. In none of those lists, Joseph Warren shows up. Wasn't there. didn't do anything. Wrong. What did he do? I speculate. Suffolk resolves. By September of 1774, the First Continental Congress was called to coordinate resistance to the British, who in the light of the destruction of the tea closed the port of Boston and hoped to shut off the activists for American liberties from Boston from the rest of the colonies. That backfired. The other colonies, rather than just looking the other way and saying those Massachusetts hotheads and radicals, let them go by their own way, were in fact agreeable to a call of a Continental Congress in Philadelphia, which was called for in the summer of 1774 and met in September. As the Massachusetts delegates, Samuel Adams, John Adams, those people, went down to Philadelphia, the ranking patriot left in Boston was Joseph Warren. And the Suffolk resolves were the deliberation of the towns immediately around Boston to what they would do in response to the British measures. So Joseph Warren was stepping out from the shadow of Samuel Adams, who wasn't present, and some of their letters are some of the most personal and politically important letters of that time frame exist, but they were letters being run between Boston and Philadelphia with a lag time of from 5 days to a week or more. So Joseph Warren had to lead on his own, often extemporaneously, and quite magnificently. So he was stepping out from the shadows of Samuel Adams. I have some incidents that happened, including the Cambridge alarm, which could have really gotten out of hand when the militia basically activated itself and confronted British appointees to the Mandamus Council in early September 1774. And Joseph Warren went out to the scene to try to calm the waters. I'm not going to talk about that here. If you read the book, you can see it. I want to jump back to this, what happened just before the Revolutionary War, and how did Joseph Warren know what to tell Paul Revere? There's some very unusual things about these account books. Here's a page from the account book. Notice the date, April 18th, 1775. This is a medical account book on the eve of the Revolutionary War. Still, there's still some patience there. An account book is a financial document, right? It's kept with names of people that you're providing services to and you hope to collect sometime. So you have to have enough information to collect those bills. Some of the people in these account books, especially in the months leading up to the Revolutionary War, don't quite fit that mold. Indian. No further identification. Just the Indian. Now, as I step back, is that a Native American? Since King Philip's War, it's illegal in Massachusetts for a Native American to live full-time in Boston. I don't know if they enforced that, but that was the law. This Indian is unusual because he always shows up, usually the first of the day, and this is a, what they call a waste book, which shows the actual order that people are coming in those days. He always shows up with the publisher of Eads and Gill's newspaper. Two of them together, they always show up. So what kind of Indian is this? Is this a Mohawk Indian, like throw tea in the water? I don't know, it's just there. But I mean, somebody just simply identified as Indian, I don't think you could ever collect the bills from. Other people, woman in Damnation Alley. Oh, Mr. Cattern. Mr. Cattern's very peculiar. I don't know anything about Mr. Cattern. I looked. The reason why Mr. Cattern is so unusual is that Warren, on a couple of occasions, paid out large amounts, I think at one point 12 shillings, worth of half pence coppers in a bag. If you figure out the money and how many copper coins are in a shilling, it's a lot of coins. And this is an account book of people owe him money. This is the only thing like it. He's paying them out to Mr. Cattern. Why? I don't know. Now, I speculate. Boston was notorious at the time with the occupying British Army and the off-duty sailors from the ships, because there wasn't anything to do in Boston except get drunk on cheap rum, and you could buy a whole lot of it for a half pence. Was Joseph Warren, and remember, he's the head of the Committee of Safety at this time, was he paying out people who were collecting information from off-duty sailors getting drunk in the bars on the wharfs? Or something else that's entirely innocent that I can't tell, because I'm not smart enough. I don't know. How about camp woman? You know what a camp woman is? They have a pretty bad reputation nowadays, but it wasn't so bad then. They were women associated with an army, on the payroll of the army, doing things like nursing and sewing and cooking and that kind of stuff. There was only one army in Boston at that time, the British Army. Who was camp woman? There are persistent rumors that the wife of the ranking general, Thomas Gage, was the source of Warren's uncannily accurate information on British Army movements on the eve of the Revolutionary War. I thought this was really far-fetched. But you have people like David Hackett Fisher, Pulitzer Prize-winning author of Paul Revere's Ride, and someone who's advised me on some critical parts of this story, in his book, says that he thinks that she may have been the snitch. So I had to say something about it. And the argument goes that, it's an argument of opportunity, that she was an American loyalist and had been married to General Gage since the late 1750s, met him in New York, where the headquarters of the British Army was before it moved up to Boston in 1774, and she was 17 years younger. She didn't get along well with Thomas Gage, her husband. She was afraid because she had friends on both sides that any outbreak in hostilities would break her heart because somebody was going to get hurt, and she had friends on both sides. So there was some reason or opportunity. The story also goes that after the Battle of Lexington, her husband never talked to her again and sent her back to England on the first ship and never talked to her for the rest of her life. Not true, but that's the story. For Warren's part, he was a widower for a year. His wife Elizabeth had passed away in May of 1773, about 2 weeks from the time that Paul Revere's first wife died. Quite possibly of an infectious illness going around during that time. We don't know exactly what. He was a widower. He had four kids. The youngest was 2 years old. The ladies judged him handsome. Reenactors around the Boston area who like to speculate about these things speculate that there not only was Margaret Kemble Gage the source of the information, but there was something else going on between Warren and her. As some people I've talked to from the Society of the Cincinnati, no less, perpetuate this. I deal with that in the book, and it's a fun part of the book. Joseph Warren, I believe his biggest contribution to America came in the time period of the early siege of Boston. This is the 2 months following the Battle of Lexington and Concord, when the activated militias and Minutemen encircled Boston, laying siege to the British Army, and the things that he did to hold the Patriot cause together in the absence of formal authority to do so, absence of money, supplies, you name it, to hold things together while the deliberations of the Second Continental Congress were dragging out in Philadelphia. Now, the Continental Congress was filled with people who were more interested in putting together the olive branch proposal in this time frame, rather than saying, gee, a war has broken out and we better prosecute it. So who's the point person holding the bag while people are dithering in Philadelphia? Joseph Warren. What a challenge. I think it's probably, and I don't think it's been recognized as this, it's probably one of the greatest pieces of situational leadership that may have occurred in American history. And although it was chaotic and a mess in a lot of ways, he held it together to think of a later expression with spit, glue, and a prayer. So when the Continental Congress did appoint George Washington to come up to Massachusetts and formulate these state militias and the Minutemen into a Continental Army, and arrived in early July 1775, the situation is described as being pretty chaotic, and it was. However, there still was a situation to be handled. If Joseph Warren failed, I suspect there wouldn't have been a United States. Well, that's just me, but let me just index the things that he was involved with. April to June 1775. The Committee of Safety is the effective executive power of the province. They don't have any power to raise taxes or money, but they're in charge if anybody is. Militias from surrounding colonies are pouring in to help. Connecticut, New Hampshire, Rhode Island. But they have their own chain of commands, and they have no formal linkage to Massachusetts except through the Committee of Safety, who takes on some members from Connecticut, and they're sort of making it up as they go along, basically. The command and control was less than crisp. So in this time frame, this is just within a day or so of the Battle of Lexington and Concord, Joseph Warren orders the collection of affidavits from participants for the purpose of putting together an official account of what happened, not only for the consumption of curious patriots in all the colonies or all the provinces, but to get that account to Europe before the official British account. He did that. He apparently wrote or headed the committee, sometimes it's unclear, of the account of the bloody butchery, and there it is on broadside, based on the depositions collected in the days after April 19th, and made sure that it got to England on the packet Quero, which beat out General Thomas Gage's official dispatches by, I think, 10 days. Meantime, he's negotiating through intermediaries with General Gage the transit of Tory and Patriot refugees in and out of Boston. This one's interesting. One of those people coming to help was the head of a militia unit from New Haven, Connecticut, Benedict Arnold. Benedict Arnold goes in the Committee of Safety, runs into Dr. Church and Joseph Warren and says, I got this idea. I hear there's a bunch of cannon up there in Ticonderoga. If we act fast and get up there, we can get those cannon bring them back to Boston, break the siege. So Joseph Warren and the committee appoint Arnold, a colonel in the Massachusetts militia. They had no business doing that. Gave him 100 pounds of gunpowder, bayonets, bunch of money, and said, go do it. Ethan Allen was on the same errand, but they're so secret they didn't even know about each other. Right? So they, Benedict Arnold goes up there, up to Ticonderoga, and joins up with Ethan Allen, you know that story, and they surprise and get the cannon. But the idea that Warren really brought that cockamamie idea forward, and who he was working with, too, I think is a little recognized aspect, which ultimately broke the siege. It's General Knox and George Washington who are given the credit for bringing the cannon down from Ticonderoga and breaking the siege without a big battle. I mean, it's a tremendous stroke. It was one of Washington's best pieces of strategy. But teeing that up was working quickly to get the guns into Patriot hands. And Joseph Warren was as instrumental as anybody in making that happen. The kind of strategic thinking that he had, I document in the book. And it's really quite impressive. Meanwhile, he's appealing to the Continental Congress to get on with things and form the army and send up a generalissimo. Because he's just handling it with his committees as best they can. Meanwhile, he had sent up his family, his four children, to Worcester. And this has not previously been known. Just at the outbreak of the Revolution, with Miss Mercy Scully, excuse me, the daughter of one of the head selectmen of the town of Boston. Miss Scully was unlike any other woman that Warren was ever involved with. She was his age, which is to say just 2 months younger. By standards of the time, I guess we might call, well, they would call her a spinster. That's not politically correct at these times, but she was unmarried and never been married. Actually, given the Patriot resistance to imported British products like cloth, one of the preferred means of resistance of women was to have homemade cloth and spin. She may have literally been the spinster. But at any rate, by the time of the Revolution, she was looking after Joseph Warren's children as governess in Worcester and is said to have been his fiancée. I believe that to be true. She later sought custody of the children. And some of those letters actually still exist in the files of the Continental Congress because they were written to and from John Hancock and Samuel Adams, and a number of leading patriots who obviously know who she was and looked at her as a person of merit. Now, what exactly she did has never really been described. She's said to have been a daughter of liberty, involving, amongst other things, writing patriotic pieces prior to the Revolution, but no one has ever suggested what specifically those pieces were, or even whether for sure she was a writer. In fact, there's no picture of her that officially exists. So one of the things I do in the book, including appendices, is to resurrect Miss Mercy Scully, who I believe is an unrecognized daughter of liberty. I have two new attributions to her, one of them pre-revolutionary, of her poetry. And this picture, Copley's mysterious lady in a blue dress, whose subject has never been known for 250 years since it's been painted, I believe to be Miss Mercy Scully, and I go through the rationale for that. So this is entirely new attribution. There aren't too many unattributed John Singleton Copley pictures around. She's buried in Medfield, who have recently adopted her as a daughter of liberty. Let me read you just a little bit about Mercy. Mercy really appealed to me. Now, Mercy went off with the children in the early part of the siege of Boston, expecting that she would be reunited with Joseph as a family, as a stepfamily. But he went off to Bunker Hill, and something horrible happened to her, and they never got married, and that kind of left her in a very peculiar position. So let me read a little bit about the subsequent life of Mercy Scully. A relationship and life together with Joseph Warren and his children were life experiences she earnestly desired and sincerely missed. Maybe they would have cemented their relationship with a baby of their own. Had Joseph Warren survived Bunker Hill and the remainder of the war, they would have been a power couple, as we might now label them. Joseph, no longer the neophyte physician, earlier dismissive of women and exhibiting a tendency to Masonic secrecy, would have matured into a battle-tested veteran, popular and energized by association with all sorts of people. He was on his way to surpassing his political mentor, Samuel Adams, for tactical creativity and effective transition from local activist to respected civil and military leader. Mercy, for her part, was a dedicated patriot, well connected amongst patriot politicians, enlivened by religious conviction, informed and articulate concerning issues of the day, and not intimidated by self-important men. It is easy to imagine Mercy and Joseph as united, symbiotic force to be reckoned with in the early Confederation and Republic's Massachusetts Governor's Mansion. Warren's friends and associates, John Hancock, Samuel Adams, Elbridge Gerry, and even his apprentice, William Eustace, all served as state governor at one time or another. Why not Warren, too? With his extensive contacts across social strata, credibility and personal appeal, would Shays' rebellion have played out in the same way if Warren were on the scene? Would Mercy and Joseph one day enter the national stage together and live in the White House? All of this is idle conjecture. History professors write of the concepts of agency and contingency, or in contrast, the inevitability of impersonal dialectics and economic determinism. Somehow it all comes together as a muddled reality in this mired field of broken dreams. I bought a yellow rose en route to the cemetery in Medfield and placed it on Miss Scully's grave. This is from Joseph Warren. I say aloud to no one in particular, you are remembered. Joseph Warren, in the days leading up to the Battle of Bunker Hill on June 17th, it is said, was lobbied by his fellow members of the Provincial Congress to be the leading doctor, the first Surgeon General of the Massachusetts Provincial Militia, as a stepping stone to the expected Continental forces. Instead, he lobbied to be a fighting major general. And they appoint, and actually I find it striking, there are not too many physicians who have ever wanted to do such a thing, much less had the choice. So other more experienced people, and there were some people around, like Artemus Ward and Israel Putnam, who had good experience military experience during the French and Indian War. They did not object to this. In fact, they thought it was a grand idea. Warren apparently was quite the charismatic person. He had participated in the Battle of Lexington. Equally, they say, as a doctor and as a fighter. In fact, he stayed close by General Heath during the skirmish at Menotomy late on April the 19th, 1775. The style was to have a rolled hairlock. Warren's hairlock was shot off by a musket ball on April 19th as he stood right next to Heath. So he was out there as a, I guess, a self-appointed apprentice soldier during the skirmishes in the early part of the Siege of Boston, in addition to everything else he was doing. So then he lobbied to be a major general. So he goes out, and this is well documented, he goes out to the battlefield in the afternoon, the early afternoon, on June 17th. And a redoubt had been built the night before. There was a lot of things happening very quickly as the American move was in preemption of a British move where American intelligence had heard the British were going to go out to Dorchester Heights and fortify it. So the Americans were going to preempt them and do something on Breed's Hill and Bunker Hill. So Joseph Warren, he's the guy with the dark hair on the right and the musket, comes out and he meets on Bunker Hill, which is the higher hill, a little bit further from Boston, Israel Putnam, who is the highest ranking general on Charlestown Peninsula. And Putnam, you know, knows Warren well from the Committee of Safety, says, "I hear you've been appointed major general. Glad to see you. The command is yours. What are my orders?" Now this, I think, is, or maybe should be, an iconic moment in American history. And I think more important than the deadly heroics that ensued. Warren said, and I'm sure the words were more colorful because the battle was actually going on at the time, said, "I haven't been confirmed in the commission. Therefore, I'm going to fight as a common soldier. Could you direct me to where the battle's going to be the hottest?" Putnam, who was supposed to be very colorful in his language, the exact words aren't recorded, but basically he said, are you crazy? You're needed elsewhere. Don't do it, but if you insist, that dirt redoubt a half a mile ahead on Breed's Hill is likely to be where the British concentrate. So Warren goes over there. Who's the encounter there? Colonel Prescott. Same deal. Prescott says, "I hear you've been appointed a major general. The command is yours. What are my orders?" Same reaction. Now, the reason why I think this is so iconic is that Warren was dedicated, and this is apparent to his letters to and from the Continental Congress, Samuel Adams in particular, that elected government should always be superior to a subordinate military. This is something that we take for granted in America, but there wasn't any precedent at the time. I mean, imagine if this scenario played out with a young Napoleon. "I hear you're Major General. What are my orders?" Matter of fact, something like that happened with Napoleon before Toulon in 1798. Reaction was different. What did Napoleon say? "I am France. Of course I'm in charge." Not Warren. Warren and his colleagues, their ideals were the ideals of the Roman Republic, of the primacy of elected government over the military. Not Imperial Rome, Roman Republic. And the importance of charters are important in masonry. Whatever his background, he insisted that if that commission had not been yet confirmed by the provincial Congress, was not yet in force, he was not a general. So things in the world that are very problematic, like in Egypt right now, the military takes over and doesn't want to let go so fast, is an issue in a lot of places in the world, but that's very foreign to our culture. And I think Warren was probably the first to exhibit that. More famous instances occurred with George Washington in 1782, when there was a proposed coup d'etat to make him king, or basically dictator. And he refused that at Newburgh, and there's a very famous speech where he does that, and he repudiated his young officers who wanted to set him up to do that. What he was doing was insisting on the primacy of American representative elective government over the military, come hell or high water, even if they weren't paid for 3 years, whatever the problem was. In more recent times, we had Douglas MacArthur straying a bit too far from the president and the elected government early in the Korean conflict. And elected government basically fired General MacArthur. That's not so automatic in some countries. And I think Warren has a lot to do with the way we do things here. If he established that precedent, he did so with his life. He did indeed go up to the redoubt in Breed's Hill, and on the third attack of the British, the Americans ran out of ammunition. Warren was one of the last to retreat from the redoubt, and this picture basically depicts him from going from life to legend, because there's at least 12 widely contradictory accounts of the last heroic moments of Joseph Warren at Bunker Hill. And this one by Trumbull is just depicts one of them. General for 3 days and not even really a general. In the days after Bunker Hill, his legend began. Here's from the other side. Had he lived, he bid as fair as any man to advance himself to the summit of political as well as military affairs and to become the Cromwell of North America. Cromwell, as you know, was the parliamentary head that unsat the British king during the Commonwealth period. From a Tory, that's faint praise, but important praise. We know that Hutchinson at one point knew Warren, had been a patient of Warren's. So Hutchinson's saying that this guy would have become the Cromwell of North America. I dare say not many patients have ever said that to their doctors. I never had anybody say anything like that to me. From people we know better, from patriots, it was considerably more positive. And John Adams and Abigail Adams were some of the people trumpeting Warren as an epitome of involved and selfless citizen all through their lives, and certainly while John was the second president of the United States. That's purported to be Joseph Warren's last words the day before the Battle of Bunker Hill to one of his associates. It's actually a quote from the Roman poet Horace. It's a sweet and proper thing to give your life for your country. Some of the speeches of Joseph Warren really have a way of speaking to you. I'm not going to go into this in great detail. They're laid out in the book in quite some detail, and they're really quite striking. Here's a quote that I'll call out from his second massacre oration. Joseph Warren had a way of looking back to positive ideals of history, of looking forward to what America could and should be, and admonishing people to action for whatever their backgrounds were to get a handle constructively on the problems of the day. This quote caught the attention of Ronald Reagan, who included it in his memorable 1981 inaugural address. Verbatim, fully attributed. Since Warren is not too terribly well known, I've set up a website independent of the book that will have all documents by and about Warren in full text. www.drjosephwarren.com. I invite you to look around there. It has notable quotes. It has full text. On the press page, it has some short YouTube videos. The one on the right, for those people who like crime scene CSI, is the forensic reconstruction of the pictures of Warren's skull, which allow a definitive view of which of those 12 contradictory accounts of what happened at Bunker Hill is the true one for the first time ever. And I have Ronald Reagan and some other fun things. We've been talking a lot about Joseph Warren. Let us leave with his words. Thank you.